And could we request our wonderful audience to welcome the esteemed panelists and the moderator. Thank you very much for giving us your valuable time. Ms. Bhardwaj, I leave the stage to you. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This is going to be a one-hour discussion. We'll try and cover as much ground as we can. And then, of course, also squeeze in some time to open it up to Q&A. Let me get straight to it then. And Anita, I'll start with you. You know, I think this is a relevant discussion to have in the backdrop of what we're seeing overall in the economy. There's so much talk about how the economy is faltering, growth is at a three-year low, and this transitory pain that demonetization and GST was supposed to, give is not transitory anymore. It's not going away in a hurry. In that context, what can be said about how things are looking as far as business in real estate goes?
Let me start off by quoting Mr. Hiranandani. I think he went on a tweet to say that the industry has had three tsunamis in a row in the last 6 months. I'd just like to add to that in an already ravaged landscape. The fact of the matter is the last couple of years have been fairly difficult for, and I'm talking residential real estate here, have been fairly difficult. Demand definitely has been muted. We've seen at least a 33 to 40% shrinkage in terms of demand from an overall industry size point of view. And in that context, if you start layering what happened around demonetization and then followed up with RERA and then followed up with GST, you're really looking at almost 5 months lost in a span of 10 months. And that's a lot for people to deal with. So I think that's something which we first need to put out there on the table, that there definitely is an issue in terms of the speed at which all of this has been coming for the industry to deal with. Having said that, from an overall perspective of RERA, let's start with that. Good from a consumer accountability point of view, good from a transparency perspective, good to push a certain level of discipline and ownership in the industry at large. I'm sure Srini will talk about whether that will result in money coming in or not, but at least I think overall an effort to create greater transparency. There definitely have been teething issues, and I think as we go down the session, we can talk a little more about it. But at least the top line for RERA would be greater accountability as we go forward for an industry, and therefore hopefully better funding, better structuring, better financial modeling around the industry.
So I just want to get like opening comments from everybody so that we know, who's on which side, and I would imagine everyone's going to be on the same. Gautam, what about you? Is the sector still sort of groping in the dark because of all these uncertainties that have hit you folks?
Like what Anita said, I would say from our perspective, the demand per se has slowed down, primarily from the residential segment sector. Being on the service provider side, what we've seen is there has been a evolution of shift in demand. So what I mean is from selling it to the end users and consumers, the products we are now selling it to people like Srini, which is providing the debt, the financing to these developers. Same is from the office sector, where the strata sale pre-lease activity was very robust with the HNI segment, has now shifted to domestic institutions. And we see these domestic institutions going out there and raising capital to deploy further, because now the clutter of the HNI is out of it. The cash from the system is out. So the trust deficit has significantly been removed from the system. So the accountability and transparency has helped us do that.
Oh, Srini, everyone seems to be pointing to you. So let me ask you then. One would imagine that the upside to all these checks and balances that are being put in place would be that the sector looks more lucrative to invest because you have visibility, especially in a market where execution is really at a premium. Is that the case, or am I being utopian here?
No, I think, look, first of all, any cleaning up from a regulatory point of view for institutional investors is always a positive. And RERA coming in, which puts certain amount of discipline with regard to usage of cash flows, with regard to delivery timelines, are obviously a source of big comfort for investors. And from our point of view, yes, we are looking at all of this as very positive, and I'm hoping that the transparency index that JLL publishes on an annual basis will put India at a higher level. Having said that, I think right now with all of the other factors, you know, RERA is a new regulation, demonetization impact is still being felt in the market, and overall the market is very, very leveraged. And then you're also seeing some of the other horror stories playing out with regard to the bankruptcy code in some of the cases. So there is a lot of moving parts here. So from our point of view, when there is a lot of moving parts as far as institutional investors are concerned, the first step would be to, you know, let's continue to do debt, which there is some level of security of what we are doing. There isn't enough capital that is coming in to take equity risk at this point in time. And a lot of institutional investors have time on their hand. They don't have to necessarily invest their capital. So we can afford to sit by and wait for developments to settle down. And that is going to hold back some amount of capital. And to my mind, you know, for example, last year was a very quiet year for us. We had nearly $400 million to deploy, and we hardly deployed $70 million because of all the reasons that is going on. So we can afford to wait. But overall, I think we are moving in the right direction.
Okay. Mr. Saraf, let me ask you, and you know, everyone, all stakeholders in the sector tell me that you're the go-to person, you know, when it comes to all things legal. How has the transition been? Because the fact is that the challenges have been numerous. It's almost been, you know, one after the other. Are we better placed than where we were, say, 6 months ago? Or is there still uncertainty and therefore is everyone on wait and watch mode?
I would say that this question will have to be answered from two sides. So far as the industry is concerned, particularly the builders and the real estate developers, I believe they are trying to absorb the shock and to come out of it, because the introspection is the mood at this point of time of the real estate industry pan-India. We are not able to make up a mind whether to have the new launches, whether to come out heavily into the market, whether to start promoting new projects, whether to sell the old ones, because only ongoing project registration is just over. The new project they are planning, they are looking, wait and watch is the order of the day. And the real estate industry is trying to understand as to how the competition is going to really take place. Because those big players who want to really come out, they are looking over their shoulder to find as to what their fellow builders are doing and how they are going to really meet with the requirement. The technical aspect of the matter about the foreign investment, about how and in what manner the mutual funds are going to invest into real estate industry, how they are looking at the security aspect of the matter. This is all different. The first and foremost thing is that how to take off the ground the project, how to come in the open, how to really market their project, and how to become RERA friendly. The builders are coming to terms with this new reality. And to my mind, there is a part, GST is not the only uncertainty. Mm-hmm. RERA is also having too many, I would say, that intricacies which they are coming to terms with. But I believe we are doing well. Last 3 months have been very educative, very informative. And let me tell you that I am not going to say that the industry is passing through some sort of gloom. I believe it's going to bloom. It's going to really come out of it. But at this point of time, it is in the gestation is on, and I believe we will see in another quarter or so that we will be able to find that the industry will come out in a robust manner with the RERA behind them and the GST settled down and the percentages and the government and the GST councils giving their own decisions on the matter. Then I believe it will be the manner in which that the industry will then come of its own and will be able to take up further.
Okay. At least that's very heartening to know that this too shall pass.
Yeah.
It may take a little bit.
It will.
Anita, let's break it up. And I think everybody here has more grouses about RERA than anything else. So let's talk about RERA. Under the RERA regime, how has the transition been, firstly? And more from a business point of view, do you think that the scope of RERA could also have been extended to, say, deal with bottlenecks from the government side that a lot of folks like you face, or, say, project financing? Is that something that RERA should have also addressed?
Well, if you look at the definition of the Act, it was Real Estate Regulation and Development Act. I think the first round has gone to regulation.
Okay.
the focus on development has yet to start. And it honestly goes back to, I remember when we were meeting various standing committees of the Rajya Sabha, they had come around different states, met people. There's such an overwhelming situation of projects being delayed by 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 6 years. Consumers litigating, consumers being upset. A lot of it closer to the national capital.
Yeah, but that, JP, I mean, how can we not talk about that?
But all of that noise has kind of switched the pendulum to the other extreme. So the first round clearly has been in favor of very high level of regulation. How has industry coped? Okay, if you look at it from our perspective, we've never launched without approvals for the last 8 years. So that's not been an issue for us. To get out there and go and register quickly was not a problem. But different states were at different stages of readiness on allowing us to register. So for example, three states came out with their RERA notifications just 1 week before July 1st. One state came out with this notification on the 1st of August and said you should have registered by July 31st. Now you needed a time machine to be able to do that. That's a different story.
So you're saying the government hasn't kept its part of the bargain?
Some states have, some haven't. I think Maharashtra has done a fairly good job of really getting the regulator up there up front, going online, a whole team being available from day one, which was issuing a lot of clarifications. So this state has gone well, and which is why I think you see large numbers of developers who have registered in Maharashtra.
You know the interesting thing is, the Maharashtra regulator is probably the best and the most proactive and probably the most advanced in terms of execution of RERA. But the Maharashtra planning authorities for approvals is the worst. So you have a situation.
That's why my question, that are your interests also being kept
You look at it from an investor point of view. You have all the problems in Noida, but you get an approval in one shot. And you can go, the developer can go and build the product. It's a different matter, they didn't build it, that's a different story. Here, you have the capability to build, but you don't have approvals. But you have accountability under RERA.
Yes.
So the point that you made, that it's a regulation and development act, regulation to ho gaya, but where is the ease of doing business? I mean, you can say that, you know, you can upload the plans and get the plan approval. You can ask, Anita and some of the others, what the reality is. You can't execute projects on time the way the regulatory process works in India.
Yeah.
And I defer to my famous post that I had done. You know, everybody is familiar with, the character Ajit. You know, Ajit says, you know, isko liquid oxygen mein dal do, liquid isko jeene nahi dega, oxygen isko marne nahi dega. I posted one, says, under construction flat dila do, EMI isko jeene nahi dega, possession ki ummeed isko marne nahi dega.
Okay, Gautam. You have a ringside view of, you know, how the sector has sort of developed over so many years. And this is clearly a watershed moment for the industry. How has the transition been? Has it, is it as painful as, you know, we hear it out to be? Because honestly, from a home buyer's perspective, and again, this is me talking, right, because I have a skin in the game. It's heartening to see that finally, a sector that had, you know, a notorious reputation is cleaning up.
Right. So from a transparency, accountability that we keep maintaining on a RERA perspective, it significantly helped. Mm-hmm. But is the home buyer able to take a decision? The answer is still no.
Yeah.
Is he now wanting to take a decision from being a fence sitter than wanting to commit? The answer is yes. Is unable to take a decision because the same project which before RERA was supposed to be delivered in 18 now says 19 end.
Yeah.
Right? So developer is provisioning a safety margin.
Yeah.
But when it comes to delivery in 18, he could come back demanding money when you're not ready to pay him.
Mm-hmm.
So which is kind of putting these decisions in abeyance, like from a Kotak Shini's perspective, I would say, from the look at it from a developer's perspective. Pre-RERA, he was using the same money to probably develop the asset and acquire more land. Now, post-RERA, that money is supposed to be kept in the escrow account, only meant for that development.
Mm-hmm.
The sales have significantly gone down. So they go to the institutions to take money from them, which comes at a significantly high cost of capital, plus the GST impact, which is also somewhere broadly in the industry. So margins are shrinking,
mm-hmm.
which is deferring the sales because he's not in a position to sell below a certain threshold price. So it's a situation wherein we feel probably a quarter, two more, something wherein more clarity would come in and it should revive.
Mm. Mr. Saraf, what gives you, you know, the confidence that things will look up in, you know, the second half of the year, as you said? Because from the looks of it, it's going to take a little longer than that.
I believe that no astrological calculation can be applied to the industry as such because it works on so many factors. But my estimation of the industry looking up very soon is on this count, that RERA, with the our authority, the Maharera authority being so very sensibly acting in the manner, starting with those who could not meet the deadline and came late, their applications are accepted. The manner in which that the authority wants to nurture the industry and not come down heavily with all the penalties which are so heavy under the law, that even if one penalty would have been imposed by now, then this industry would have shaken up and shuddered about what would happen if there are going to be further small or larger delinquencies on the part of the developers. So I believe that the RERA authority is acting in a very prudent and I would say that matured way. Secondly, that the industry has taken very well to the provisions of law. RERA has become almost a household word. From the customers to the builders and the developers, everybody understands the basics of it. I, as a lawyer, find that my clients are very well informed. Their questions are well formed. They are matured. The rules are in place. The forms are in place. The understanding between MOFA and RERA is extremely clear. And the people have been behaving in a manner whereby RERA is absorbed. So I find the RERA impact is absorbed by the industry. But surely one thing with the financial wizard sitting on this panel, the investors and particularly the mutual funds and the institutions are very wary of advancing money to the real estate industry because of lack of clarity under the bankruptcy code, and also about the position under RERA, because that is where you don't get the priority for the purpose of taking over the project, and you stand next to or subsequent to the purchaser's body, which is supposed to be taking over the project in the event of there being a default by the builder. Now, this situation is creating an uncertainty which will dry up the source of fund for the industry, and that's a very serious concern. Once this part is taken care of, and I believe everybody is working towards it, including the Government of India, and there is an amendment on the way with the bankruptcy code, which I believe will bring in and ease up the stress which is there in the industry.
Srini, that's a bit ironic because if, you know, headlines are anything to go by, and I'm actually alluding to something I read just yesterday, KPMG put out this report saying that, you know, investments in real estate have hit a record $7 billion in India here in 2017 alone. And, you know, it seemed to really talk up the investor mood. But here it seems that everyone's sort of, you know, scrumming for cash.
Well, I think, you know, it makes for nice, good copy, nice headlines. It's, you know, in your screen, it'll look nice, $7 billion. Let's look at the reality as to what the money is coming in for. The majority of the money, if you look at it, has come in to buy already built up assets.
Okay.
It's not coming in for development. I mean, you saw, you know, $2 billion being given to DLF for buying the office assets. You saw CPPIB buying the logistics assets. You saw GIC buying the Viviana Mall. Where is the money coming in for development? The development risk is being taken by developers in this room, the banks and NBFCs which are funding the developers, and the domestic investors who are putting money in alternative investment funds. Once that is fully built and developed, the only risk the international investor is willing to take today is probably some rental escalation risk and, you know, occupancy risk, that's all. So big money is not coming in for development. So it tells you where the investor perceives the risk to be. Development is still perceived to be so risky that investors are willing to buy assets at 8 and 9% cap rate, but not willing to take what one assumes is a more profitable investment when you actually do development. So the bulk of the money, that $7 billion that you talked about, has actually either come into stabilized assets or a very significant amount of that has come in as debt to real estate developers.
Okay.
So whether it is coming in through NBFCs or otherwise. So I'm not, I'm not a big fan. I think the domestic investor, domestic developer, they're taking the greater amount of risk. And they're actually giving the stabilized assets on a platter to the international investors.
So what needs to be done to change that?
First of all, our domestic institutional investors must have the maturity to go and buy these assets. I want to know why LIC is not buying these assets. World over, insurance companies buy office assets because it gives them, you know, when you buy an insurance policy, you put a liability of 20 years on the insurance company. Mm. So are the private sector companies. Yeah. When you have a liability of 20 years, you have to have assets of 20 years which gives you cash flow. So our institutions are sleeping at the wheel. They are not buying the assets, whereas they should be buying the assets.
So but as a
Sri, sorry, on that, I think that's been changing over the last 2-3 years wherein insurance money has started coming into the core assets where they're buying floors, they're buying premises, which are...
There is a problem there. There's a problem there. Why is Blackstone and CPPIB and others able to buy these buildings, and why is a Kotak Life Insurance or a SBI Life Insurance not able to buy this building? There is a simple regulatory issue there. All these transactions that you saw were sale of shares of an SPV. A Blackstone or a CPPIB buys the shares, which and that SPV has only the building. None of the insurance companies in India are allowed to buy 100% equity of any company. So, wo building khareed nahi sakta. If they go and buy the building, who will pay the stamp duty?
But I think it's also
so this to do is with a regulatory issue. So we have ourselves created so many barriers that we are actually giving it all to the, you know, international investors on a platter.
Isn't it also to do with 5% of your corpus is what you can only invest, and then you're risk averse, so you want to buy a floor rather than...
That is less of a limitation. I think 3 insurance companies can get together and easily buy a building worth 500 crores. Not a problem. But this regulatory issue is there. They cannot own 100% of a company.
Okay. So let's talk about GST.
But before that, Taneia, I think there was a mention about risk. And I go back to the point you made earlier on RERA.
Yes.
And the development aspect of it. One of the, you know, demand risk is something that all of us have to do with as part of being in business.
Mm-hmm.
That any business would have to do, whether it's manufacturing, services, real estate. The struggle that you have in this industry is the regulatory risk. And we spoke about the timelines taken for approval. We spoke about how long it takes to get land title cleared, issues around that. And a large part of what is required as intervention from the government is really resolving that risk around time,
mm-hmm.
resolving that risk around title, resolving that risk around regulation. Because market risk, whether it's construction costs or whether it is selling price, is something that is inherently part of doing business.
Mm.
And you will go out there and take your calls. You make a mistake.
But I'm sure you must have pitched that to the government.
So we have. Yeah. And I think the whole point is about the immediate response is that, you know, approvals are state subjects.
Yes.
Now, the counterpoint is that if you could get RERA implemented across all states in the country, then why can't you yearly push hard towards ensuring that you get a single window clearance or whatever equivalent mechanism is there across the country?
Mm.
At the end of the day, if you're going to take 18 months, 24 months to get approvals, it is capital which is lying there locked and getting more expensive, which in turn impacts the customer from a point of view of how much he can afford that house for. So the whole mechanism of bringing in that aspect of development, making the industry more efficient, and therefore removing the risk profile is very, very critical. I mean, we were having a conversation over lunch about the risk weightage assigned to real estate by banks versus any other asset class.
Yeah.
So really a lot of the focus going forward for the government needs to be around how do they systematically disengage the risk profile of this industry in areas that they can control.
Okay. That's a valid point. I'm glad we got that out of this discussion.
Sorry, you were asking about GST.
Yes, I was. I wanted to talk about GST because, you know, right now there seems to be no unanimity amongst builders when it comes to input credit under GST, which is, of course, now at 12%. And that, as a consequence, has maybe kept home buyers, you know, at bay, in the hope, perhaps, that that would change. My question is really twofold. One, is that something that you at Mahindra have seen is confusing home buyers? And are you hoping that the government will give some relaxation, for example, you know, keeping it to 5.5% for projects that are, you know, already underway?
There's no confusion at two ends of the spectrum. If you look at ready-to-move inventory or finished goods, there is no GST. Come to the other end of the table, which is a new project which is launched.
Mm-hmm.
there isn't going to be any confusion, because when you launch a new project, yes, there is GST of 12%, but all of your services, contracts, your raw materials are anywhere between 18 to 28%. So when you do the entire maths, it kind of evens out. And so there isn't really any incremental issue, because earlier the customer was bearing 5%. Today, in a new project situation, the impact would be about 2 to 3%, depending on what your economics of your project are. The problem really is in the ongoing projects. And a bulk of the inventory out there in the country is ongoing projects. Now, if you as a customer went to your developer, he would give you an input tax credit number, rupees per square feet, which is very different from, say, what somebody else would give and what somebody else would give.
Yes.
Primarily because each of us are in different stages of construction. So if I've already finished 60% of my project and I have only 40% to go, I can give you only input tax credit for what comes in the future. And therefore, I'm able to give you, say, 200 rupees, whereas somebody else who's 20% built out is able to say 300 rupees. Somebody else is saying, I don't even want to do the maths today.
Yeah.
Because I don't know when I finish the project how much I'll have unsold, and therefore what set off I will have to write back, and therefore let me calculate all of this at the end. Mm-hmm. So you're hearing, and then there's somebody else who's saying it's so high and I'm struggling to sell at the moment that I'll just give zero GST for the next 3 months to boost sales.
Yeah.
So as a consumer, you're hearing zero GST impact on price, you're hearing 6%,
yes.
You're hearing 2%, you're hearing 4%, all kinds of numbers. And that obviously is creating a certain amount of confusion. Added to that, I think CBDT has put out its press releases on the fact that developers are not passing on input tax credit, GST is actually bringing prices down. It creates, again, a further set of confusion, because everybody seems to be forgetting about construction WIP or ongoing projects. Mm-hmm. And that really is the crux of the matter. So it is important, again, that the government looks at that whole CWIP portion or the ongoing projects portion, mm-hmm. and actually re-rates at least that part very differently from the way they've rated.
So what are the feelers that you're getting from the government?
It's still early days. I think what we've told them is this is a category you need to address.
Okay.
You don't seem to have realized that this is an industry which builds over 3 to 4 years. It's not a manufactured product put out tomorrow morning.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, we need to address what's ongoing projects in terms of rating it at a lower rate of GST.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we have about 15 minutes. And before I just throw it open for, you know, Q&A and invite questions from our audience, you know, I wanted to get a word in on, again, what has been grabbing the headlines. And that is what has come to be almost a test case in real estate, JP versus the home buyers. And that's where I wanted to bring, you know, the bankruptcy code into this discussion. It seems that it doesn't ring fence the home buyers. Do you suspect that maybe some amendments are really the need of the hour?
The amendments are on the way. I believe government is serious about it. Various bodies, and there is a lot of lobbying going on at this point of time for the amendment, and which is, it's high time that the government will come up with that. Because unless that is done, not only the Gurgaon case, which has shot the headline, and the attention it has received from the all on pan-India. But the question which arises is that without giving the status to the purchaser as a secured creditor, mm-hmm. the position under the bankruptcy code is going to really leave him high and dry, and he will not have any relief. And he won't have any chance as a group of purchasers or individually for the purpose of claiming any right of a secured creditor. And in that direction, I believe government is active, and the body like this and the kind of a meeting like this, if giving a special attention to this subject, will bring about the amendment little faster. And it is on the way, and it should come. And without that, I believe that we'll have a serious concern, because RERA has its own limitation.
Right, and that brings me just to my point. Do RERA and the IBC work in tandem, or does one override the other?
Strictly speaking, there is nothing common between RERA and the insolvency code.
Okay.
Because the fact is that the RERA is for the purpose of protection, by and large. It mm-hmm. is for the protection of the purchaser, and it is to monitor and to control the real estate industry, which exponentially increased, but without any sort of some sort of self-discipline, and there is no code of conduct. The complete code by itself is now applicable throughout India. It's an extremely dynamic law which has come about, implementation apart, and it will take its time, but it has to be implemented at the end of the day.
Okay.
So far as the bankruptcy code is concerned, it operates in another area altogether. And giving priority to the purchaser, giving priority to the real estate purchaser into the bankruptcy situation is not the subject matter which concerns RERA at all.
Okay.
RERA talks about the project and nothing more. And in that sense of the word, I believe that they both operate into different orbit, and therefore there is nothing comparable between the two.
Right. Okay, we'll open it up to questions then. Any questions? Yes, please go ahead. Should we bring you a mic? So, can someone get him a mic, please?
I fully agree with you. The question is that two laws cannot operate in different direction, and we will have to synchronize the two. And according to me, the priority is that the relief must come, because RERA believes in time-bound delivery. RERA believes in the protection and the ultimate consumer welfare which we are talking about. And therefore, the moratorium situation, or for the purpose of when whatever are they supposed to be restrictions which gives a some sort of immunity to the people who commit default, will have to be taken care of, and this has to be brought in line. There is no doubt about it, and I believe that the amendments are working towards it and will have to do it, and there is no two opinion on that.
Okay. Before we just carry on, I would just like to welcome Abhishek. He's here with us. Unfortunately, you've joined us only during the Q&A, Abhishek, but I will just get...
Apologies for the delay.
I will just want to, you know, set the tone. We've, of course, been talking about more than the triple tsunami, as Mr. Hiranandani calls it, for the sector. If you can just maybe talk to us about, you know, what it's been like 6 months on. Are we still clutching at straws, or are things looking up, or at least, you know, there is some hope on the horizon? Both when it comes to GST, RERA, and demonetization.
My view about the triple tsunami, I thought that it's largely one cyclone, which was demonetization. Clearly, demonetization had a very significant impact on economic activity in the country. Across all sectors, and equally real estate was affected. My own assessment is that RERA, while different states have done it differently, and therefore there are different pain points which are varying by the state, I think Maharashtra has done it very well. We've had the most proactive RERA regulator. They've been quite efficient when it comes to the process of registration as well as resolving issues. And to me, over the medium term, RERA is a very, very welcome change, which reduces the risk perception of the industry, and in the media, and then therefore will lead to a lower risk premium that buyers will need to pay or will be seeking from developers in the course of time. RERA will also, of course, you know, put an end to ways of doing business which were anyway not acceptable. And will ensure that the industry becomes more healthy in the medium term, as well as helps, you know, weed out the men from the boys. Because if some business model is predicated on doing things the wrong way, that business model is no longer likely to be successful. Somebody might still try, but it's no longer likely to be successful. Finally, GST, you know, quite frankly, below 5,000 rupees a square feet, and I know Mumbai doesn't matter so much, but across the rest of the country, that cutoff of 5,000 rupees a square feet is quite significant. It covers 70-80% of the supply in the country, mm-hmm. and it actually is neutral at that price point.
Okay.
So, you know, I think the GST, from the perspective of the whole nation, the widening of the tax net, buoyancy in revenues over time for the government, and therefore the government's ability to spend on building national infrastructure is a welcome move. Clearly, in a city like Mumbai, at over 5,000 rupees a square feet, there is a challenge because the total cost of ownership has gone up. And what that really means is that construction cycles, there will be more of a focus on delivering faster, because as soon as you deliver, as soon as you get your completion, the GST goes out. So buyers will prefer buildings which are complete or have received the OC, and I think developers will be incentivized to make sure that they shorten as far as possible the construction time frame. So just as it happens in commercial buildings, that once you start construction, you want to finish as fast as possible because the lease rental will only start coming in from the date you finish. Mm-hmm. So equally, in some sense, that incentive has been created on the residential side, because now as soon as you get your completion, GST goes away, and there's almost like a 12% benefit that the buyer gets, and consequently your sales are likely to take off. So I think the incentive for real estate sector over 5,000 rupees a square feet is good. The immediate hit is challenging. So I think demonetization was a problem. The other two are, you know, I think decent things in the medium term.
Okay. Somebody had a question? Yeah.
Hi.
Oh, okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Given the incentive to complete,
Given the incentive to complete and given the penchant for Mumbai developers to permanently keep a project under construction because kal kuch naya GR aane wala hai, naya DCR aane wala hai, naya scheme aane wala hai, FSI badhne wala hai, kuch amalgamation ka naya scheme chal raha hai, to project ko construction mein rakhte raho taki FSI badhta jaye, complete kabhi nahi hota hai. Do you think that practice will stop?
I think, Srini, your question sort of answers itself. I think developers who have been able to do well in Mumbai, or for that matter in India over the last 4 or 5 years, are those who have spent money on construction rather than on other things and have delivered their projects. And delivery involves making decisions at certain cutoff points. It doesn't, you know, the market today does not permit you, let alone GST, to keep elongating your project endlessly, because the market understands today. I think if I would ask you before November 6th last year, November 8th, whenever it was, when this sort of cyclone tsunami business started, was everybody in a hunky-dory state? I think not. I think whenever the last session of NAREDCO of this event happened, or similar such events, we were equally in a concern mode that the market is not doing as well as it is. We are now sort of, you know, trying to say that the market today is not doing well because of these three things. But the fact is that there has been a supply-demand imbalance across the country. Mumbai has less of it because of its peculiar characteristics. Across the country, there has been a supply-demand imbalance now for 3-4 years. And that is the underlying cause of the problem in the marketplace. And these three, while we can blame them for whatever problems we may be facing today, 12 months later, I think the fact is that these may still be there. We'll have to change our ways of doing things, and those who change, adapt, will be successful. Those who don't will have challenges.
Yeah, my question is to Abhishek and Anita ji. I am also a developer, and we all have been hearing this quote of Niranjan ji, which Taneia has been saying, we have seen three tsunamis. But there's a small number of tsunamis which are being thrown to us, like typical case of raising a demand to a customer. GST rule says, irrespective of received amount, 12% is the GST payable the day you raise the demand. So now we have a challenge that we have an unsold inventory which has got piled up in the system, which Abhishek is saying demand and supply. And whatever you have sold, because of confusion of RERA and delays and what, customers are little shying to make the payment, and you are raising demand, you are not getting your payment, but you have to pay 12% within 15 days to government. So it's adding to a cash crunch. 70-30, because of the RERA, the 70% escrow mechanism, which is requiring you to have certificates to be produced for removing that money. So how much government expects builder to bleed? And on the other side, we are saying that we want faster deliveries.
Well, I wish we had somebody from the government on this panel. But
I don't think I represent the government, so I'm not sure I'll be able to answer that one. Yeah, I mean, it is a practical issue. you do have to pay GST when you raise the demand. The only submission I can make is that if you have any concerns about whether a customer is going to be on with you or not and is contemplating staying on a project, then there's no sense in mindlessly raising demands. You might as well do resolution of the customer at that point in time in terms of whether he stays, whether he goes, whether he's discounted and made to stay, and then raise subsequent demands. So it has to, it's an operational issue.
Yeah,
it's not something that you're really going to be able to turn around and say, I will not pay the demands.
Challenge is, without raising demand, banks are not going to disperse. And when you raise demand, then you have to pay the tax. And what happens if there's a cancellation? There's a long process of getting the refunds. So these are the issues which we need to agitate, escalate.
Yeah.
Regarding GST, my name is Mr. Sainath Rajadaksha, I am from Koinur. Regarding GST, there is no clear indications. There is a lot of problem regarding TDR, whether TDR is applicable for GST or GST is applicable to TDR or not. Nobody is giving clear answer because TDR is, we are in Mumbai getting for land and GST on land is not applicable.
Abhishek, you want to go, but to my knowledge, it is applicable. What I've heard is it's applicable, but not sure. I mean, the whole, the view is that it's
the same answer
it's transfer of development rights is being treated as a service and not the underlying land, which is immovable property and therefore stamp duty.
Any other questions?
This is a question for Srini, and if Anita and Abhishek can also opine on it, we'll appreciate that. You know, I represent an international developer. So far, we have not put any money out through debt. We've only put money out through equity. And I wanted to specifically ask Srini, the amount of debt which has gone into real estate in the last couple of months, years, don't you think that's like a fourth tsunami in the making?
So, well, you've pulled a full toss to me, so... So let me say, the previous time when investors were over-enthusiastic in India, in 2006 to 2008, I said these companies are getting valued on the basis of land banks. I said these land banks are soon going to become bank lands. Now we are seeing that in JP and other cases, it has become bank lands. Insofar as debt is concerned, and I was mentioning this earlier, 90% of the transactions that we see for potentially financing are a refinancing transaction. He's borrowed from him and he needs to be paid, so he wants me to lend him again and this guy will be paid. And then the original lender is still not paid, now he will come to him to borrow from him to so that the new guy is paid. I've seen some of the situations and I completely agree with you, that is a time bomb waiting to happen. It's like a musical chairs, one by one the chairs will go off, let's see who's left standing.
Any other questions? We've got
so
time
Srini,
for one
can
last.
You expand on that a little more? Are you saying it's still better for you to put out more equity money? Are you still chasing equity strategies, knowing that this is a time bomb in the waiting, or are you still happy to put out more debt capital?
No, I'm not looking to put out. I mean, look, I have money for both equity and debt. Right now, neither of them are paying me the rewards for the risk underlying that. On debt, Parimal sir has already talked about, you know, if I'm going to stand behind the bank and the customers and the mortgage finances, merely to kuch nahi bachega. So I'll wait. That is not a problem at all. As far as equity is concerned, land prices have not yet come down to sensible levels. What we are seeing anecdotally is that successful and developers like Mahindras and Lodhas, smaller, weaker hands are willing to give up their projects. And they are simply giving up the projects for execution expertise from the larger players. And there is no capital involved in some of those situations. So we have to wait and watch as to how this will go. But there is a lot of moving parts. And you know, between bankruptcy code and all these other regulations, we will have to wait and watch as to what will make sense. The risk reward, both for debt and equity, is very, very thin right now.
So are you saying that the industry must operate in suspension or in abeyance for some time, till such time that these things pan out? Because without the support of capital, without clarity from the key stakeholders themselves, how will the industry move forward? How will we continue with the growth pace? How will we continue with the vision of the objectives, you know, for which this conference
right now
out?
The industry should enjoy the debt available, which for the same projects is available at lower and lower rates. So you please keep borrowing and come out of whatever the problems that you are, as long as the tap is open. So that's the good part. There is enough money in the system. There are enough money, people who are willing to give money at very attractive rates. And those who are serious about execution will eventually come out of it. I think the issue is where you're continuing to keep on refinancing and you're not delivering, you're not executing. I think both the lender and the borrower will be in trouble.
Yeah, go ahead.
Since I started the question, you know, one of the concerns that I have is I agree with Shrini that from a developer's perspective, it's great to take this money. But there was a movie which was made, it was called The Big Shot. This is a smaller version of The Big Shot because ultimately, when the chips fall, the last person who's holding the baby is going to be the sufferer. And eventually, there is always the guy whose pension is going somewhere, or it's always the end consumer who basically suffers when all the cards fall down. So I think that's the big concern with this whole debt play in real estate.
Yes and no. In the current context, it's obviously the customers who have bought the property. But eventually, I think the belief is whether if, you know, we'll see the test case that's going on in Delhi, whether how is the government going to sort of step in and solve the issue. And I think fortunately, I think the size of the problem. Government, I don't think the government is going to come and solve an NBFC's problem. That is, we are reasonably clear. If the government is not solving the problem for government-owned banks, I don't think they're going to step in and solve a private sector NBFC's problem. So we'll have to wait and watch. But at the end of the day, we can rely on the fact that the customer will not be left, you know, holding the baby. But there will be sacrifices involved by all parties, the developers, the lenders, and the customers.
Shri, I'd just like to add one point there. I think the whole interest arbitrage piece works when the underlying asset is more valuable to the person who's taken the mortgage than the cost of servicing that mortgage. And if you have land prices going down because the person is struggling to service the mortgage, then that whole equation suddenly stops being relevant. And so, yes, I would agree with you that there is that underlying risk. If you're having the same debt getting financed and refinanced and refinanced, the very fact that the debt is moving from a 21, 22% to 14, 15% is telling you something.
No other questions?
Can I take a last question for Parimal Bhai? Parimal Bhai, you know, we've heard, and we heard Mr. Gautam Chatterjee yesterday talk about RERA and about the effectiveness of RERA, and you also alluded to how it's a unified code effectively now across the country for consumers. But again, RERA tribunals are not judicial bodies, to my understanding, but they're trying to act as quasi-judicial or judicial bodies. So on one hand, you have a regulation, but on the other hand, you don't have a regulator with enough teeth or enough powers or enough sort of punitive strength. So does that by itself make RERA ineffective?
No, for your information, your impression is not correct. RERA is a complete code. RERA has got adjudicatory powers. Several powers it enjoys the Maharera authority, but it has got judicial powers. And in fact, there is a bar under RERA that you can't go to the civil court for resolution of the disputes which could be resolved by the RERA authority. Now, therefore, RERA is a judicial body. It adjudicates upon the disputes. There is also now an announcement which we read day before yesterday that about reconciliation of the disputes or the arbitration aspect of the matter is also getting introduced under the law. But RERA will be able to take care of all the disputes between promoter and purchaser, purchaser and purchaser. And in certain cases, RERA will also have a power, which I believe this panel, I heard somebody talking about it, that what happens to the planning authority? It can issue directions to the planning authority. It can summon a planning authority. It's some sort of a single window situation which is coming up. It all depends upon how the RERA authority really acts and implements. And we have a lot of hopes from Mr. Chatterjee, because I believe he means business and he has got vast experience and he is going to set right this thing. And once, if the planning authorities also come within the sweep of RERA and there are orders passed or they are brought to book, and Mr. Chatterjee in one of the functions spoke that even if we can probably admonish them by making references, though they may not be within direct powers of under within the scope of the RERA authority to direct them to do something, that will also make a lot of difference, because at this point of time they go scot-free with all the delays for whatever reasons that they do. So RERA is fully equipped to deal with this, and I believe that this is the precise difference between MOFA and RERA. That in MOFA you had to go to the civil court for the resolution of your disputes. Now everything is under one roof and it is going to take care of all your disputes, which will be resolved. Then there is appellate body provided for, and ultimately you go to the High Court. So it's a complete court and it should really take care of the situation.
Okay, I'm afraid we've run out of time. Thank you so much, everybody, for listening to us, and hopefully it was worth your while. Thanks. Thanks, everyone. And families.
Thank you very much. Could we request the panel to pose for a photograph? Thank you. And if you could just step in front, a little in front, please. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, could you please join me in thanking our wonderful panel? I would request Mr. Hitesh Thakkar, Vice President, NAREDCO, to kindly come up on stage and present Ms. Taneia Bhardwaj with a token of appreciation. We request Mr. Maulik Dave, the committee member, NAREDCO, to join us on stage and present a token of appreciation to Mr. Parimal Shroff. Requesting Ms. Tara Subramaniam, committee member, NAREDCO, to present a memento to Mr. Abhishek Lodha. Mr. Anish Shah, Joint Secretary, NAREDCO, you're requested to join us on stage and hand over a token of appreciation to Ms. Anita Arjundas. Mr. Hitesh Bhaktani, the committee member, NAREDCO, sir, you're requested to join us on stage and present a memento to Mr. Gautam Saraf. And we request Mr. Sumit Agarwal from the Hiran and Nani group to join us on stage to present a token of appreciation to Mr. S. Sriniwasan. Thank you very much.